Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, our wonderful people all over the world. We welcome you at Grace and Hope at Alkaraza TV. We ask the Lord to bless you tonight as he bless us to be in this program tonight to tell the word how we love Jesus and we give the word of God to many people. Maybe some part they don't know who is Jesus is, but tonight we'll have to come to you with a blessing from our Lord Jesus to be with every home that they're watching today. We pray for everyone that they're watching in a blessing to be with them, for the God healing touch to everyone watching and he feels sick. To everyone, they need to hear a testimony. We are tonight to worship in our word and to be with you, to reach you with the wonderful people as we meet every week with the wonderful people of God. And our topic for today, how to be light wherever you are. How to be light wherever you are, as the Lord in the book of Matthew chapter 5, he mentioned, be the light of this world. But are we a light in this world? Are we carry the name of Jesus? Or we said we are Christian, but we don't have the light of Jesus. Tonight we'll meet with a wonderful young lady. She's an actor, producer, speaker, and she's a wonderful writer too. Wonderful young lady that we meet with her, and I believe God use her wherever she is in her entertainment business that we have with us, wonderful believers too, Mary Grace. Good to have you with us, Mary, tonight.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Wonderful to have you. And actually, it's a blessing to have young lady like you working in entertainment business in Hollywood and wherever you are. Mm. You are the light in this world for to carry the name of Jesus. Wonderful. And we will see a little thing about Mary Grace before we more continue with who is Mary Grace.
This looks like it could be pretty epic. Mary, tell me about the movie.
Okay, well, Final the Rapture, it's a thriller. It will definitely keep you at the edge of your seat from the beginning to the end of the movie. It's just totally packed with action and drama from beginning to end.
What's your role in the movie?
Well, I play Rochelle Nelson. I'm the wife of Colin Nelson, who is a football player in the movie. He's one of the four characters who, I don't tell too much, but gets left behind, you could say. And I also play a college student. I'm a student of Tom Wiseman. He's the atheist professor in the movie. And you may have seen some really comical pictures of him, like, running for his life in some movie stills online. So I'm basically in the lives of these two people. And when the action really hits, they start to remember my character. And my character had a very influential role in both their lives. Some people call the character of Rochelle Nelson the moral compass of the movie, or like basically she stands up for God. She she talks about the end times and warns Colin before anything happens. And in the classroom, she just stands up for what she believes in her faith. And then, you know, when things happen, they start to remember her.
Did you go to some of these pre-screenings, and were you actually part of the ministry teams that prayed for people?
Yeah.
Cool.
Tim flew me out to Houston, and I was there almost a week for the opening weekend on September 13th. And I was there, I was signing autographs. Yeah, I have some pictures posted on the IMDb, and there's also some on my personal website, which is marygracetoday.com.
What happened to you?
A leaf bug.
What?
A leaf bug. I was sitting on a bench back in March in the park, and I saw this little bug, and he had the shape of a leaf. I mean, suddenly everything just started to make sense to me at that point.
He's a loving God, and he's also a God of judgment. He can't let evil persist. It's going to come to an end, a resolution. When he comes and takes us up, then it's going to be the end. Don't be deceived.
How disappointing. You were one of the top students in philosophy. What's come over you?
I had an experience. And it made me a believer.
Praise the Lord. We back again to you. And this is one of the movie our guest play in this movie. And we'll ask you a little bit about it. It's Final Departure, which is, I believe, that before the second coming of Christ. Mm-hmm. And I need to hear a little bit before I have a question about this movie.
Yeah. Well, it was shot in different countries. Mm-hmm. My scenes were shot in L.A. And it's a story about these four characters and basically what happens when Christ comes for his church. And it, mm-hmm. The movie is based on the rapture. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the main point that the producers and of the movie wanted to get across is about being ready for Christ's return whenever that is, whether it's the rapture.
Okay.
You know, or anything else. Mm-hmm. And when we toured with the movie, we just really highlighted the fact about just being ready for Christ's return.
Wonderful.
And if we meet him today or tomorrow, mm-hmm. I mean, no man is promised tomorrow, so we should always be ready.
Yeah, that is song said, tomorrow is not promised to me, because only through Jesus we have now. Maybe we are sitting in this studio and suddenly Jesus, he said, okay, I'm coming now. And yeah. What we say, welcome. We need you, Lord Jesus.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Like a twinkling of the eye, you know, it's going to be that quick, a half mm-hmm. a blink, like all of a sudden. And the mm-hmm. scripture says two will be in the field. You know,
yes.
One is going to stay and the other one taken. And we don't know. We mm-hmm. just don't know. So we just have to always live being ready.
And is still this movie play in the theater or not yet?
It was released in theaters, Regal and Premier Theaters in the South mm-hmm. in 2014.
Oh,
and
wonderful.
And then it went to Video On Demand and DVD, Walmart, Target, Barnes mm-hmm. & Noble, like everywhere online, and in DVD copy, which is, mm-hmm. people still buy DVDs in some places.
And thank you for the copy you gave me today.
You're welcome.
God bless you. One of the things we start with always, I know you are actor and the same time producer, a writer, speaker. Mm-hmm. And I know all about you, but people, they don't know how you start, how, and I know you are a woman of faith too.
Yeah.
And to be actor, working in entertainment business in Hollywood, and to be light in this world, that's, I believe, a little difficult. But before we go through that, let our lovely people know who are you and how you start.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Well, you know, the Bible says that they will know that you are his disciples by your love one for another.
Mm-hmm.
And as a kid, that's what I saw. You know, as a kid growing up in the church, mm-hmm. My parents brought me to church, and mm-hmm. I wanted to go. I wasn't one of those kids, like, you know, being dragged or mm-hmm. forced, you know, like a lot of kids. I actually looked forward to going, and mm-hmm. I did feel that love in the church, and I had really amazing experiences as a kid with the real deal. I mean, mm-hmm. people who were the real deal. They mm-hmm. loved God. I saw their walk of faith as a kid, and it was an example for me. My Sunday school teachers, my pastor, and I just love that environment. So mm-hmm. I had good experiences, and I can say that, you know, that really did influence me.
Wonderful. Yeah.
It did, from a very young age. And when I was in first grade, I got really sick. Mm-hmm. We lived in a bit of a polluted area in New Jersey. It's where I grew up. And I don't I don't always talk about this, but I think I feel like I should. And
yeah, of course.
We don't always have control, like, of how we're brought up, mm-hmm. whether we're brought to church or if we're raised in a clean environment or mm-hmm. a city or the country or wherever. Mm-hmm. And it really affected my health as a kid, and I was throwing up my stomach lining. I was throwing up green bile, and the doctors didn't know what to do. I just was so weak, and I remember sitting in my chair in school, and I had to, like, hold myself up because I was so weak I couldn't sit up in the chair.
Wow.
And I almost had to stay back because I missed so much school, and my parents were people of faith.
Wonderful.
But what happened is when the doctors couldn't do anymore and they didn't know what to do, I just mm-hmm. wouldn't respond to the medicine, they brought me to the church.
Oh,
for
yes.
prayer.
The best doctor.
Yes. So, you know, even people of faith, you know, mm-hmm. like, I mean, doctors are good. They're fighting the same enemy mm-hmm. that we are. I mean, doctors are amazing, but there's
of
a time
course.
Where, mm-hmm. you know, medical technology and doctors can only do so much.
Mm-hmm.
And we need something supernatural.
That's true.
We need a miracle.
Yeah.
And that's where I was.
Mm-hmm.
The doctors did everything, and nothing would work. So they brought mm-hmm. me to church, and the scripture says in James that the prayer of faith will save mm-hmm. the sick.
Amen.
And if there's any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church, and that prayer of faith will save the sick mm-hmm. and raise him up, and if he committed any sins, they will be forgiven him.
Hallelujah.
And as a child, I witnessed this scripture.
Mm-hmm.
There was a man that he was one of the elders. He prayed over me. And, you know, I didn't understand everything. I was in first grade, mm-hmm. like 6 years old maybe. And I just knew when I went to the front and when that man prayed over me mm-hmm. with his hands up and calling on Jesus, that I started to feel better.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
praise God.
I didn't know about religion and mm-hmm. formulas or... And it wasn't about that. It was, I felt the love of God, and his faith was just mm-hmm. evident. And I began to respond mm-hmm. to the medicine. I began to heal. I started to be able to eat again. I threw everything up.
Wow.
And that just really began my journey with the relationship mm. with the Lord and knowing God as my healer.
How old were you at that time?
Well, I 6 or 7, maybe it was first grade.
Mm.
So,
yeah. And you start from there to know the Lord. I hear that from you, like you use scripture in the Bible. How you went through that, how you know about Bible.
Yeah, I just started to fall in love with this presence of love that I felt in the church,
mm-hmm.
You know, through his people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, God cares enough to heal me, you know. And, you know, when you're a kid, people kind of just... You know, you're not always respected mm-hmm. as a child, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't feel that way in the church.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when they prayed over me, I mattered to them. My healing mattered. How I felt
mm-hmm.
mattered. And
mm-hmm.
And after that, I tried to bring my entire first grade class to church with me.
Wonderful.
I got a huge stack
you
of, like...
You become a little missionary.
Yes. We had these Sunday school papers, and mm-hmm. I asked my teacher, oh, can I bring them for my class at school? And she let me. And I had, like, 23 of them. And I passed them out on all the desks. I was just so happy. Like, I had energy. I could walk around. I wasn't, like, worn
mm-hmm.
out because I could... Everything I ate was just... I was throwing up.
Mm-hmm.
And... So I was just so excited about my healing, and I
Wonderful.
Wanted to tell everybody what Jesus did and bring them all to church with me.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think anyone came, but they all got a Sunday school flyer.
Oh, but you know, that testimony, I believe, how God healed you,
mm-hmm.
that goes as a root in your in the foundation of your faith
yeah.
to be as a Christian and to believe that he is the healer
mm-hmm.
from young age. And that when you start to believe and to... Well, I know you went to school after that for to study
yeah.
about Bible.
Mm-hmm.
But in the same time, how that work with you? Like, when you start to be an actor and when you start, we need to hear a little bit about your life, about your journey.
Yeah. Well, I always had the call of God on my life. And, you know, as a teenager, I sometimes people would ask me to preach in their church. Mm-hmm. You know, I was just a teenager. But people just recognized that call on me and my enthusiasm for evangelism. And I started a bus ministry from scratch with my friends. And, mm-hmm. You know, just wanted to reach kids and youth and just the people with God's love and grace. Yeah. And when I went off to school, I had full scholarship for mm-hmm. school in Winter Park, Florida, Rollins mm-hmm. College.
Oh.
I went there first before seminary, and I got involved in acting and some mm-hmm. modeling, mm-hmm. and I did it for fun. And I was doing it for fun, and I was booking things, and I never took an acting class, and I was booking films, and mm-hmm. and everyone was telling me, you know, you need to go to New York or L.A. because, you know, I was just a natural.
Mm-hmm.
And I enjoyed it. I loved it. And, you know, my journey led me here to Los Angeles,
uh-huh.
where I went to Fuller Seminary while I've been mm-hmm. acting. Mm-hmm. And around the time where I was graduating my first master's, intercultural studies.
Wonderful.
That's another story, like where I prayed and I said, God, if you want me to stay in Hollywood and mm-hmm. And be a light here, I ask you for a Christian movie. Mm-hmm. I asked for it. And mm-hmm. the word says, you know, you have not because you asked not.
Of course.
Yeah. You know, so I thought, let me ask. Like, let me just ask. You know, I'll do non-Christian films. Most of my work has not been Christian. Mm-hmm. I've done film and television. But I wanted to do something Christian for a change. Mm-hmm. You know, just one would be nice, you know, I thought. And mm-hmm. A week and a half later, long story short, the producer says that out of 1,000 girls, I booked the role mm-hmm. of in Final of the Rapture, one of the leading females.
Oh.
Yeah.
I believe the Holy Spirit, one of the chosen, chose you.
Mm-hmm. And at the time, I didn't have an agent. It was a project I thought was a small project, and it blew up. And before you know it, I'm signing autographs mm-hmm. at theaters. I'm traveling. I was on Telemundo TV. Mm-hmm. It was in the Florida Today mm-hmm. newspaper, Orlando Sentinel. Like, it just took off. And mm-hmm. Just like that, you know. And so I stayed here, and then I ended up going back in school for my MDiv, mm-hmm. the mm-hmm. divinity degree.
Mm-hmm.
And just I've been both working in the church and, you know, serving outside the church and in film and television, and now I'm writing. Mm-hmm. So just a mix of, you know, just being a light and salt in the world, not just in the walls of the church, yeah. but out there in my career.
Wonderful. And you are a speaker and writer at the same time. What kind of books or what stories you write or something?
I am currently writing one now. I'm on a third chapter. Mm. But I'm hoping to finish this year.
Oh.
That's my goal anyway. But it's a spiritual book, mm-hmm. and I want this book not only to, similar to the way I believe with my career, I want this book to reach everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be attractive to everyone in the world, not just Christians, but it's going to be a message of hope. It's mm-hmm. going to be a message of love. And it's a little top secret right now, but mm-hmm. It'll go into different aspects of who we are in Christ and mm-hmm. how to live that out.
And to be light, how to be light.
How to be light and be love in this world. And a lot of that, it's, you know, when we know who God is, because we're made in His image,
mm-hmm. Amen.
Then we'll know who we are. And, you know, like the more I've learned who God is love.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. You know, I mean, just that in itself, mm-hmm. God is love, and we're made in His image. We mm-hmm. are love.
Yes.
Because we're His children. Mm-hmm. We come from Him. And, you know, it says in Genesis that He created man and woman in His image, His divine
yes.
image Amen. That we were made. And God being love, we are love. And that, just knowing, the more I know who God is on my journey, and as I continue to know who He is, the more I'm going to know who I am in God.
Mm.
And it's liberating.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when you know you are loved, you think differently. You act
of course,
differently.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You respond differently. to have that acceptance that, you know, no matter what, I am loved.
Mm-hmm. And you feel your value in who you are. You are the daughter of the King of Kings. And some people, they don't have that. They don't have the love. Mm-hmm. To see the love of Christ, they need to go through something to know the love of Christ. But you already see the love of Christ, mm-hmm, through your sickness and your teenager's age and all. But we believe that God use you in that place, entertainment business, to be a light in that world, that they need to know the love of Christ.
Yeah.
Because they don't feel love. Like, I meet with many people, they work in this kind of business, mm-hmm, they don't feel anything. Only they want to do acting, they want to reach their goal, but there is no love.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And that what...
Right. I mean, where there's no love, there's pain, there's hurt. And, mm-hmm, we as disciples of God, disciples of Christ, they will know us by our love one for another.
Amen.
If that is missing, then... Without love, we're just noise. It says in the Corinthians 13, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. Like without love, it's just this banging cymbal, like racket. Mm-hmm. Like, we can talk and talk and talk, but it's just going to be this racket, this noise, like a cymbal. And, mm-hmm, it's not going to mean, everything we do is not going to mean anything if we don't do it in love.
Yes.
If the people don't feel love. And, if we want people to come to our churches, we need to show people love and acceptance. I mean, no matter what they're doing or, how they're living, you can see Jesus as our example.
Yes.
I mean, he never treated, anyone, differently just because of, how they were living or, sinners. I mean, mm-hmm, he was known to eat with sinners and dine,
oh, yes,
with sinners and,
uh-huh,
and be friends with sinners. And that was why the religious people, the church, were, mm-hmm, like, oh, who is this guy who, eats and dines with sinners,
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus' church was out on the fields.
Oh.
And he spoke to thousands outside on the fields and not in the walls. I mean, he did speak in the synagogue.
Yes.
He did read scriptures in the synagogue, and there was one time they chased him out and tried to stone him because,
mm-hmm,
they didn't,
that's
like,
true,
what he said.
Mm-hmm.
So it just shows that, wherever we are the church.
Mm-hmm. The body of Christ.
The body, right. We're the, mm-hmm, body. We are the temple.
Mm-hmm.
And it says in the scripture that we glorify him in our temple, which is God's.
Mm-hmm.
So,
amen,
wherever that's at, wherever we go, just to shine that light and that love.
Yeah, we are all sinners come by his grace, wherever we are. And we are here. The Lord loves us. God loves so much the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And that when we know that the Lord himself forgive us our sin, that forgiveness is love. And that's what you carry in your business, that you carry in your heart to reach these people with the light of Christ. I believe we have somebody calling now. And, okay, we'll go back. Praise God. But in the same time, one of the things, now you work in this kind of business, mm-hmm, and in the same time as a Christian. Mm-hmm. And is that difficult for you to be Christian working in Hollywood business? And we know this day is movies. Sometimes you cannot be with the bad words and think that as a Christian. What difficulty you face in this kind of business?
Well, it says in the scripture that we're to work out our own salvation with, mm-hmm, fear and trembling. And I think, Christians who work in any business,
mm-hmm,
or any career, we need to have an established boundary. And that may look different for me than it looks for, mm-hmm, someone else. And, that's between the person and God,
Of course,
I feel.
Yes.
And,
mm-hmm,
and I have my boundaries where, I won't say the Lord's name in vain. Like, Jesus Christ is the name that I pray in. It's not a curse word. So there's been times where it says Jesus Christ as a curse word in the script, and I've said kindly, you know, not condemningly or judgmentally, just kindly, you know, I'm convicted about that. Can we say gosh or maybe something else? You know, I feel convicted of saying Jesus Christ as a curse word.
Yeah.
In this, even if it's in the script.
Mm-hmm.
Being an actor, we play different roles. Mm. And I, you know, I'm okay with playing characters that aren't Christian. That's fine.
Okay.
But I have my boundaries.
Oh, okay.
And like, that's one of them, you know, where I'll take a stand and I'll say, you know, I can't say that.
Mm-hmm.
And they usually understand, and we're fine with it. I mean, it's happened maybe, like, I know once, maybe twice. So.
Oh, yeah. And they understand what you want.
Yeah, they
And they agree with you?
Yeah, they get it. Like, you know, we all have our our convictions, and they actually respect me more because of it.
Wonderful.
Because I took that stand, and they'll rewrite it and put something else. Because they can just put a real curse word there instead.
And that's why we need to go with the belief, what we believe in that area to them, to let them know we stand to our faith. And that's, I believe, have you ever shared your faith with a, like with some people that you think you need to share your faith with, and they accept it or not?
Yeah, absolutely. I won't say who or where it was, but there was one time we were eating lunch on the set, and something I hear a lot, you know, this very famous actor, you know, he said, like, he'll never step foot in the church, that, you know, he's done a lot of really, really bad things, and he didn't think, he could be saved, and just condemned, feeling condemned. And like you were saying about John 3:16, you know, Jesus came into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through him may be saved.
Amen.
And, you know, and he did a lot of drugs and things like that, and we talked for over an hour. And I just shared with him the love of Jesus. Like, you know, God doesn't condemn you. Like, he comes to set you free. He wants to set you free. And he receives you how you are. And, you know, it reminds me of, you know, this story where Jesus talked about the sinner who said, you know, pounded on his chest. And then there was the Pharisee. He was like, I'm glad I'm not like that sinner. And the sinner was like, Lord, have mercy on me. And Jesus is like, the sinner who is humble and saying, God, have mercy on me, you know, walked away justified,
more
justified. And a lot of people in the world and on the set, they're good people. You know, they're good people who have hurts and pains, and they think, you know, the church won't accept them, or if they've done really bad things, they can't go. You know, the church, you know, they get this view of the church, like you have to be absolutely perfect. And so I think number one is letting them know that there's love and forgiveness, and there's no judgment or condemnation. Like, that's most important. And in that case, we talked for, a good hour. And at the end, he was just like, wow, like he was just really, like, surprised, like that I even would talk to him and accept him because of all these bad things that he did. And it's like, but our sins are as far as the east is from the west. When we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You know, who are we to hold that sin against anybody when someone confesses it?
And you know, you mentioned something here about people, like, sometimes maybe people, they feel guilty. They don't deserve to go to church. And that our job to come and tell them, come as you are. I know there is some churches, they look, oh, we need everybody to be perfect, but nobody is perfect. Churches open for imperfect people. And no, who is perfect? Not me, not anybody is perfect. Only Jesus is perfect. And here, when you talk to them, of course, they have a lot of problem, if drugs or alcohol or sexual or whatever, is that word you give them, I believe, will never back to him void, because God, when he speak through you, that people, they will look to you and said, okay, let us learn from her. Let us hear from her. We see her different than others. And the love in you can change them. And you feel that you have little testimony to share about something happened like that with somebody. You was a light to him to lead him to Christ or her?
Yeah, there's another time where I was at a Hollywood party. And I would go with a girlfriend, and two by two. And we would say, God, you know, just lead us if there's anybody that you want us to talk to. Or And we were drawn to somebody, and we led him to Christ at this party.
Hallelujah.
He grew up Catholic, and but drifted a bit, and he was crying, and you know, gave his heart to the Lord.
And it was in a party.
At a Hollywood party with, we'll just say, lots of drugs and alcohol and a lot of other things going on. And that was one that made into heaven. And the Bible says, you know, the angels will, all rejoice. Heaven will rejoice.
Amen.
In the darkest places, there's people who want God. And they're hungry for the Lord. And they, you know, Jesus said that, you know, the harvest is ripe, but few are the laborers. There's a huge harvest out there.
That's true.
And I tell you, like, you know, going into these dark places, the people are open. They're hungering. You know, they're hungering for something more than what they have. They want more. And that's why drinking. That's why they're doing drugs. Because they're looking outside of themselves. They're hurting. They're trying to either cover up that pain, or they're looking. And but they're looking in the wrong places.
Yes.
You know, they're, you know, maybe through relationship after relationship to fill that missing void of love and acceptance, you know, numbing the pain through alcohol and drugs. But the answer is the love of God. The answer is Jesus.
Yes. You know, we cannot be light in the world without Jesus, as he is the light, and his light give us to be light in this world. And like, we are powerless, helpless without Jesus, all of us. But when these people, I believe, when they see the love of Christ, and they will come to him, they will come to see, yes, I need to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. And I believe, you know, I work as a counselor too, but in the same time, I can see people, how they deliver through the Word of God. Not in the 12-step programs, not in anything, but more to know the Word of God. And they admit, I need help. And somebody to come to you and talk to you about their problem, that means they tell you, I'm direct maybe, I need help. And I believe I ask God to bless you wherever you are, Mary. It's a blessing. A young lady, beautiful like you, to be a light in, like you said, in a party. And party, Hollywood party, everybody knows about, as you said. But through this party, you meet with somebody and change his life completely to meet the Lord and to save. That's why we are not afraid. When we go to these places, we carry the name of Jesus. Nothing can touch us if we are strong. And if we are not strong, we will be maybe like them. But I believe you are strong in the Lord. And when you go to give that word to these people, God deliver them as he did for this young man.
Amen.
Yes, praise God.
It's an adventure, you know, and Jesus said, I've come to give you life. That more abundantly. You know, we don't have to live like boring lives. And like,
of course not.
Living for God is very exciting. It can be very exciting. It can be an adventure.
Yes. Amen. And that's what, and you go through that with the help of the Lord, the direction from him and his plan. One of the, you chose your movie, like, you are now actor, and let us see, maybe one of the big company of movie come to you and give you this story. And that actually, it changed your life, it changed you. And it was good money and good names, not good company names, but the story is not good for you. Mm-hmm. Did you accept this kind of story or no?
Well, you know, like I pray about everything, mm-hmm. Like every role, whether it looks good or doesn't mm-hmm. look good. And, mm-hmm. you know, like I have to feel right with God when I stand on Judgment Day one day, you know, the most important relationship in my life. And I tell all my friends this, and especially mm-hmm. ex-boyfriends, mm-hmm. is the most important relationship to me is my relationship with God.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And if you're helping bring me closer to God, then this is going to work out, you know. And, you know, so that's how I live my life and my career. And, you know, I have to have the approval from the Lord before I do any movie. And it doesn't mean that it's every project's going to be Christian. But if I feel God wants me to be a light on set and a light in that movie, and I feel I got his green light, I'll do it. But mm-hmm. I pray about everything. There was a film that I turned down. I'm not going to say what it was. It was actually a Christian movie. And you would never have thought I would have turned it down. But mm-hmm. sometimes
you don't feel comfortable.
Sometimes what looks like gold isn't gold.
Oh.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What looks good isn't good. Mm-hmm. It appears to be good, but it's not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I prayed about it, and I just didn't feel right about doing it. And, you know, the movie, the script was good, but it was the marketing, and it was targeting certain people.
Oh.
It had a negative connotation to it, and it was attacking certain ministers. Mm-hmm. And the more I prayed about it, I turned down a leading role.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
And I didn't want to be part of it, mm-hmm. even though the script was good, but I felt... And it was Christian. It's like, no. So, you know, whether it's a Christian movie or whatever movie it is, I have to feel...
comfortable to do it.
Feel that, yeah, God wants me to do and be a part of that project.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
As you said, not everything is gold. Look, good looking as gold. Maybe yeah. it's 14, not 24 karat gold. And that we need to be careful, too. Mm-hmm. It's not something like many... They said, we are Christian, but they are not Christian.
Yeah.
And that even in the world here, we can see. You can see them by their light. Mm-hmm. And some of the movie, even sometime a Christian did, they called themselves Christian. Mm-hmm. It wasn't to glorify the name of the Lord.
Right.
Yeah, like one time I was watching a movie about Jesus, the story of Jesus. Mm-hmm. One of the movie I love about the Jesus of Nazareth, this is, I love it. Mm-hmm. I watched that many, many times, and I have the three CDs of it, like all of the movie. But that, another movie I watch about Jesus, I don't feel comfortable to continue to watch it even.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I said, no, I cannot even watch it. The way they're talking, the way it's not respectful, I refuse even to continue with that movie, to watch it.
Mm-hmm.
And that sometimes we need to be careful, even with our word, as we said, oh, this is a speaker, she's a Christian, or he is Christian. And you go to hear from them something is not Christian. Mm-hmm. What do you think about this? How we can know about this kind of people? And about this kind of, even with the pastors sometime, even with the churches, when you go sometime, you don't feel comfortable with about their teaching.
Yeah.
And I believe the Lord warning us about there is wrong teaching and wrong prophetess, that we need to hear from you. How you deal with this?
Yeah, well, I've dealt with it even recently where someone said to me, God said you're going to marry this person. And mm-hmm. absolutely
they named
not.
That person too?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
I mean, absolutely not. And you know what? People make mistakes. I want to think that way. People mm-hmm. make mistakes. But The Bible does say that in the end times, there's going to be false prophets who are going to rise.
Yes.
And they can even lead the very elect astray.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to be careful. How are you feeling? What is your gut saying? What is your intuition saying?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all have that inside voice, you know, mm-hmm. and that we need to tune into. And when we pray and we meditate and we get quiet, we can really tune into that even more. And just be careful out there. You know,
yes.
not everyone's your friend, and not, mm-hmm. not everything that looks like gold is gold.
Yes, that's
and
true.
And there are wolves in sheep's clothing.
Mm-hmm.
And that it's a journey.
Mm-hmm.
It's good to be around other believers who, you know, we could say, what do you think of this? Or have you heard of this person? Or how do you feel? But most importantly, how do you feel? How do you feel inside?
That's true.
And if you're getting some red flags or you don't feel comfortable like mm-hmm. sitting and listening to them or what they said to you, then
mm-hmm.
just kindly dismiss yourself and walk away.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, I was not interested in this person to marry them, but I was told and it wasn't true. And I
mm-hmm.
think, I don't know if there was ulterior motives there or not, but people can make mistakes. Some people may do it unintentionally. Some people
mm-hmm.
may do it intentionally, but we have to know for ourselves.
That's true. You know, it reminds me with the real thing happened with one of a friend. She was at church. She's a so pretty lady. And a guy came to her and he said, oh, the Lord told me just now, you are my wife. And that's happened.
Mm-hmm.
It's something like. And she looked to him and she said, the Lord told you that? And he said, yes, the Lord, I hear his voice clear that you are my wife. And she said to him, but the Lord, he doesn't tell you what I need to do with my husband and three children. And here,
oh.
here you need to hear the really the word. Like this man, he came to her and he said, the Lord told me you are my wife. And you know how people, they mislead
mm-hmm.
by this,
mm-hmm.
especially girls.
Mm-hmm.
Like they, I know one of the pastors, he passed away now. I hear it by my own ear from one of the ladies. She said to me, when I come to this church, I see him, where is the building is standing there, and he come to and said, you are my wife, come to here. That pastor, he was like Paul the Apostle. He never married and he died and went to be with the Lord without wives.
Huh.
What, you know, this kind of people, they mislead by wrong voices they hear.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about that?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it definitely could be a wrong voice they hear or one that they made up themselves, you know, to help their business or whatever, or maybe they're attracted to you, who knows?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's like, where is the fear of God?
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
where is the fear of God? I mean, to say that God told you to marry somebody, whatever it is, when you say God told me this or that, I mean, we need to have a reverence for God. Where is
mm-hmm.
the reverence today? Where is
mm-hmm.
the fear of God? It's like, if I don't know, like, for sure,
mm-hmm.
I'm not going to say God
you
said this or God told
if
me
God,
that.
Yes.
You
mm-hmm.
know, or if I'm not sure, I'll say, you know, I think this or I feel
mm-hmm.
this,
mm-hmm.
you know, but when we're saying, thus saith the Lord, or God said, you know, We better know it's God.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean that, I just wish the fear of God and the reverence of God would fall on the church again and his people. Because in the book of Acts, when they lied in the presence of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
it didn't go so well.
Yeah.
You know, so if we really want the move of God in our lives and the move of God in our church,
mm-hmm.
then, you know, we need to step up and start being careful what we say, go what God says, what we're doing.
Which is true. Like, sometimes you go to places like churches and all, you see people, oh, God told me this, God told me that, even from congregation. It's
mm-hmm.
not like puppet area or ministers. But the Holy Spirit in you can lead you if this what they said is true or false.
Mm-hmm.
And the warning, as you said, the red light warning,
mm-hmm.
it give you in your spirit. that the Holy Spirit in you lead you if this is the right person or the wrong person. But for you, have you ever heard, this is the right person, this is the right person I need to be with, but he wasn't?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have our journey, and sometimes it's harder to hear for yourself. It's easier to hear for other people, you know, the prophetic gifts. And I've dated some people, and the Lord has shown me a lot in dreams. He speaks to me a lot in dreams.
Mm-hmm.
But it confirms what's already in my heart. You know, you kind of know.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of know.
Of course, yes.
I've dated a couple of people, and there's your will. There's you know, God has a destiny for us, and there's also our will. There's fate, and there's our will.
Mm-hmm.
And God lets us choose.
Yes.
He'll guide us, like the Bible says, like we. He'll direct our paths. We can try to plan our path, but He'll direct our paths.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so we all make mistakes and we start over again.
Yes. We fell, but we stand up.
Yeah.
You know, it's wonderful to talk about your life and about how you start from the beginning and how God lead you. But you obey. That's obedience better than sacrifice. And that's what you did. You obey the God call to your life, and that's blessing. You know, we'll stop to take a break now, and from there we'll go to a different subject about, we'll wait about in the 14, we will have Mother's Day. And of course, there is a lot of mothers watching tonight, and we need to honor them tonight with our program too. But let us take a little break with Mother Prayer.
Need to find a place. God, how with your grace, give a faith so shall we say. Lead on to a place, God, how with your grace, to a place where
praise the Lord. We back again to you with the blessing of our Lord Jesus in you today. Actually, we have wonderful time to talk to you about your entertainment business, about your life, about your faith. And we believe the Lord chose you. One of the things about mothers, we need to come together to talk about and honor mothers today. I know you are wonderful, you're still a young lady, not married, not have children, but I know you have spiritual children. And first in Sunday, the 14th, this coming Sunday, we have the Mother's Day. And we wish all the mothers happy, wonderful Mother's Day. We ask God to bless you, to be with you, to give you wisdom how to be good mothers, to let a new generation come forth with the word of God and knowing what God doing. Now, I know you are here. Actually, there is somebody here, the song, and they call. Hello, somebody calling. I don't hear you well, the brother, please.
أهلا وسهلا فيك أخت سوريا.
أهلا.
إزيك ربي يباركك.
شكرا ربي يباركك أنت كمان. We'll speak a little Arabic here.
أصلا داي مدى داي حبيت أمسهل الفرصة وأقول لك هذه مدى داي.
أو الله يخليكي. وأنت كمان ربي يباركك وأنت طيبة وأولادك وجوزك وكل شكرا كثير ربي ربي حلو. بتحبي تشاركينا في حاجة؟
أيوة قد إيه المفروض يعني اختبار الأخت ده رائع وأنا بصراحة يعني أنا برضه بس قد إيه يعني قالوا لي البرنامج رائع جدا ومش البرنامج ده بس يعني كل البرامج بتاعتك
الله يخليكي أنتي بركة شكرا
فيها حاجة رائعة منحة رائعة ربي يباركك
شكرا حبيبتي ربي يباركك أنتي كمان ويهديكي دايما
ربنا يكمل معاكم وسلامي للضيفه العزيزه بتاعتك وربي يبارككم من فك المجد كل سنه وانتم طيبين.
وانت طيبه شكرا. شي وسع شكرا اختي مروه. God bless you. سلام الرب يسوع. She talked about, she wished us a wonderful Mother's Day. And you are welcome. As she said, she's a wonderful lady. She has a program here. She was here today live too. Oh. But she called us to wish a happy, wonderful Mother's Day. Again, shukran. And thank you so much for this call. We wish you too a happy, wonderful Mother's Day. And God bless you. We want to talk a little bit about mothers. But first, I know your mother, she's a wonderful lady, and to have daughter, and you said in the beginning, your parents, they are believers.
Yeah.
How your mother influenced you in your life? What her influence in you?
Well, I can say, like, I mean, I realized it as I got older, what a sacrifice it was, you know, when I was little. Mm-hmm. I mean, I grew up very humbly, you could say. We were a bit poor.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't have things that other kids had, like
mm-hmm.
if everyone had some famous sneaker, you know,
yeah.
We didn't have the sneaker.
How many brothers and sisters you are?
Two sisters, a younger and an older.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so they're working class people. And one Christmas,
mm-hmm.
they couldn't afford to get us any Christmas gifts.
Mm.
So my mom sold her engagement ring so we could have Christmas gifts.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And, you know, that's a mother's love and mm-hmm. sacrifice. And I could say, like, I've seen that self-sacrifice in my mom. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we could have gifts for Christmas. I mean, her engagement ring, you know, that's...
Oh, that's so value to her.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, so that definitely, you know, was impacting. And also, you know, just sharing the love of God with me as a kid and bringing mm-hmm. me to church and teaching me to believe, you know, if I was sick, well, ask Jesus, you know. Mm-hmm. mm-hmm. They would always lead me to the cross. So I'm very grateful for that.
For both of your parents. Mm-hmm. And you have another sister, like you are two sisters.
An older and a younger sister. Mm, yeah.
Wonderful. Yeah. And they have the same faith as you have.
Yeah. They grew up and, you know, and they have their own journey. Mm-hmm. but yes, they do. They're believers in God and have a strong faith. Mm-hmm. You know, I could say, like, my parents lived it out. Mm-hmm. You know, I saw it. And it was strong. Like, God is real. And when there's a problem, go to him and ask him. And mm-hmm. and it was like they expected an answer. Like, they expected a healing.
Hallelujah.
And I grew up with that expectancy that mm-hmm. God answers prayer. Mm-hmm. And there was this magnet. And they still have it on their and we've moved around a lot of places, my family. And they still have this magnet from mm-hmm. when I was in first grade, and it said, God said it, I believe it, that settles it.
Oh, wonderful.
And
yes.
It just, I mean, that was my roots.
Mm.
And, you know, and just, you know, walking out that faith as a mom, like I can say my mom definitely showed that sacrifice, that love, that she would sacrifice her own things so we could have toys.
Oh,
yeah.
That's wonderful. And, you know, God rewards her, I believe, now where you are now. And to see that, how you're growing in the word faith and the word of God, that's, I believe, she did a great job. And your father, too. We cannot ignore, because father and mother work together in unity. Yeah. And, you know, when you build the house in the foundation of the word of God, and to see that growing of the kids, no matter what we face daily, we know he handled our days, he handled our table, he handled our food. Mm-hmm. And that, I believe that what your parents was doing, and in the same time until now, mm-hmm. They are together, and that blessing.
They still are together.
Praise God, hallelujah.
Today's my Wonderful. Dad's birthday, by the way, too.
Oh, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Dad.
Happy birthday to him. Now, you said you have spiritual kids.
Yeah.
I need to know a little bit about your spiritual kids.
Well, my spiritual kids, some of them are older than me.
Oh, yeah.
They're all different ages. I definitely have, there's people in my life that I'm there for, that I pray with, that I meet with and have lunch mm-hmm. with, mm-hmm. minister to, and they minister to me. You know, we minister to each other.
And
you know, just like a proud mommy, I'm proud when I see them growing mm-hmm. and, you know, overcoming this or that. I mean, if I can have thousands, even millions of spiritual kids, I'm going to be fulfilled, mm-hmm. really fulfilled.
Praise God.
Yeah.
And that when you, like, you have a wonderful relationship with this people that you call them your spiritual kids, and you, like, you give them the word of God, they talk to you.
Yeah, they can text me or we call, you know, we talk on the phone, we'll meet, you know, we'll meet up sometime in person, you know, or if they have a, I've even fasted for them, you know. It's like, okay, you know, maybe I'm enabling my child. But, like, you know, if they have a hard time fasting or they have medical issues, I'll fast for them. Like, you know, I want them to hear from God, and I think God graces that.
Oh, hallelujah.
You know, I'll do that. It's
the love in you.
Yeah.
That from him. You know, there is many obedience, as we said before, even in your work, when you go to do whatever God wants you to do. That's blessing. In the same time, to be as an actor, and you have spiritual kids, that's blessing. Wonderful people, they will say, oh, okay, my mom in spirit is Mary Grace, and that's really beautiful. You know, many mothers these days, they don't know how to treat their children. We know there is some problems with the mothers these days. And we need to talk a little bit about mothers. But one of the mothers that I honor so much, of course, happy, wonderful Mother's Day to my mom, Mary. And her name is Mary, too. And I wish you, Mom, a happy, wonderful Mother's Day. You are so blessing to me. And in the same time, the Mother of Christ, mm-hmm. that one I honor so much. Yes. I love Mary, Virgin Mary, as the story said, as she, you cannot see mother, see her son, crucifixion, mm-hmm. and to feel the pain like Mary did. And that what I always, in all the program I do about mothers, I should mention her.
Yeah.
I should honor her.
Yes.
Because she's the one carry the pain that no one can carry in her heart. She was know from the beginning who is Jesus is, but she continued to follow him. In the same time, to talk with people with love and to see him in that cross was so wonderful. But in the same time, it was shame and pain to her. Would you like to talk about that?
Absolutely. I was actually named after Mary, the uh-huh. Blessed Mother. My mom was miscarrying me.
Mm-hmm.
And she cried out to God, and she said, God, if you save my daughter, I will name her after mm-hmm. your mother. Mm-hmm. And I was saved.
That actually what I ask you about is, your name is Mary Grace.
Yes.
And I need to talk to you a little bit, but continue, and after that say, why is Mary Grace?
So I was saved. She was bleeding, and my grandmother came over just to help as well. My mom had to be off her feet for 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was saved, she kept her promise to the Lord and named me Mary, and then my middle name Grace, because I was saved by God's grace.
Hallelujah.
So that's where I get Mary Grace.
And that's your birth name, like in your birth certificate, Mary
yes.
Grace.
And I use it. It's my SAG name as well. It's mm-hmm. my Screen Actors Guild name.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
So I'm known as Mary Grace. And yeah, it's an honor to have that name. I mean, Mary, when everyone fled and hid, and when Jesus was crucified, she stayed.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a mother's love. You know, mm-hmm. she stayed at the cross.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that was hard. And today I know a lot of mothers see and witness very tough things that their kids are going through, whether it's brought on by themselves or injustice.
Uh-huh.
And there's so many good mothers out there who stick by their kids,
mm-hmm.
and they're there through that pain, and they watch the pain, they watch their kids go through pain, and but the mother's love, it hangs on, and you know, I know there's some mothers out there who are hurting. Maybe their kids are in prison,
yes,
uh-huh. or you know, maybe they're really sick, and you hurt with your son or your daughter, but it's that mother's love that will get you through and will keep you. Because that love comes from God.
Amen.
And, you know, we call God Father. However, you know, Jesus said, oh, how I wish, like a mother hen, I could gather you, Jerusalem, up with my wings
mm-hmm.
and just hold you. But, you know, you would not. I mean, there's motherly aspects to God as well, you know, where he has that motherly instincts. And mm-hmm. And there's another scripture in Exodus where when he delivered them out of Egypt, he said, oh, like how he bore them on his wings, where like eagles fly under their little ones. Mm. So if the little ones who are learning how to fly fall, they catch them with their wings.
Yes. Uh-huh.
So God likens himself like a mother eagle flying under his little ones to mm-hmm. catch us.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's those are qualities of God, again.
Hallelujah.
Those are qualities of God's love is the mother's heart.
Mm-hmm. And that's, mm-hmm. you know, wonderful, as you said, that wonderful word. In the same time, mothers, they're facing a lot of things. Good mother can lead her home and her children to be as your mother, as children of faith. They are children of, you know, they can face many things in their life without problem. Then when they know the problem, there is the problem, they come together and pray together, and in the same time, they're facing things and to give it to God, that the good mother do. But you know, and we live in society, here we need to talk a little bit about, we see a lot of mothers, of course, parents. Like sometimes I feel parents, they are not good to be a parents. Like they are in many situations, maybe they are in abuse to their kids, or they do something wrong to get their kids. Mm-hmm. What do you talk about, what do you think about this kind of parents? Mm. They don't treat children well, and they abuse their children.
Well, it's wrong. I mean, first of all, just put that out there. I mean, abuse is wrong in mm-hmm. any form. It's wrong,
mm-hmm.
and God doesn't. Mm-hmm. God doesn't want us to abuse our mm-hmm. children or anybody. God is love. So you know, parents who feel unfit or you know for whatever reasons they're abusing their kids, it's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And if you know anybody who's doing that, you should call authorities and mm-hmm. definitely report it. You know, but there's redemption, you know, there's forgiveness, there's healing. People can change. God can transform their hearts.
Yes. Uh-huh.
You know, there's hope. There's hope and forgiveness, too,
mm-hmm.
you know, for that. And abuse goes deep and it hurts and it causes deep wounds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but there's healing and there's forgiveness. So, you know, parents who are that way, you know, I would just encourage them, if they're
mm-hmm.
listening,
mm-hmm.
to call out to God and ask for his healing, because
mm-hmm.
you need healing. Someone who is hurting someone else, you're hurting.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think they need healing. And you know, I would just say call out to God and ask him to heal you and deliver you from whatever's causing you to hurt other people, whether it's verbal abuse or physical abuse or whatever kind of abuse it is. If you're finding yourself hurting other people, just get along with God and just say, God, help me.
Mm-hmm.
And he will help you.
Mm-hmm.
You ask God for help.
Amen.
He will answer. He always answers. And it may not be in a loud, thundering voice, but maybe it's still a small voice. Maybe you'll feel a little bit freer. It'll be different. So I just want to encourage, if anyone's listening and you're finding yourself, oh, you know, you're abusing your kids or any family member or anybody, you know, just ask God to help you and ask him to heal you and set you free. Because he came to set the captives free, because that's captivating. I mean, that's miserable. You know, when you're hurting other people, you are miserable.
Yes,
you're hurting your
true.
Own soul. And God wants to set you free, spirit, mind, and body. And he's able to do that through his blood,
mm-hmm.
through his
Amen.
Grace, and through his blood.
Mm-hmm. I feel you need to pray now, Mary. I know you are a wonderful believer, and you pray too. I like to pray with, as you speak. I hear somebody need to repent, somebody to, he need or she need to feel there is some change in her life. And please, can you pray with these people? And
yeah, absolutely. Jesus came into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through him would be saved. And saved is, it's not just a spiritual salvation. It's deliverance. It's healing. It's called sozo in the Greek, and it's just spirit, mind, and body healing. And if you want to be free today, if you need healing, if you need deliverance, if there's something that's holding you bound, and a temper, maybe anger, sickness, whatever it is, it's captivating you. Maybe it's a way of thinking. Maybe you just have obsessive thoughts about something. You know, whatever it is that's captivating you and holding you back from being the person that you want to be, that you know you can be, I just ask you to just agree with me right now and just pray. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you right now, and I receive you as my Lord and as my Savior. I believe that you died on the cross for me to set me free from sin, from bondage, from anything that's captivating me. And I ask you for help. I come to you and I ask for help. And I ask you just hold your hands out and just receive. This is just a physical way of just saying, God, I receive.
Hallelujah.
And just receive His Holy Spirit right now. Receive His grace, because His grace is a gift. Salvation is a free gift. It's not something you've earned. It's not how good you've been, the good things you've done, how perfect you lived. All of us have fallen short of the glory, the goodness, the beauty of God. All of us, every one of us has messed up. We've all messed up. We've all fallen short. But it's through His love and through His grace and through His blood that He forgives us and He sets us free. And He gives us this free gift of eternal life. It's not something we've earned. And He will give you righteousness. So just receive His righteousness.
Hallelujah.
Receive His holiness. Receive His forgiveness. Receive His love. Let Him love you. Receive His love.
Hallelujah.
And as you receive His love, just let all of that other stuff just leave you. And just let it go. Just as an act of faith, just push it out. Push out the anger. Push out the unbelief. Push out the doubt. Push out the pain. Push out the hurt, the unforgiveness, the bitterness, the resentment. Just push it out. Or even the self-hatred. Push it out. I am loved. I'm accepted by God. I'm a daughter of the King. I have His righteousness on me. I am loved. And I shine in His grace. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Wonderful prayer. And I believe touched many hearts tonight. And if anybody, you can see our number in the screen. You can call us. If you have any prayer, if you have any share about whatever you feel our conversation today touch you, you can call us and let us know how that word touched your heart. And we believe the Lord Jesus, He is the God of yesterday, today, and forever. He can heal you. He can do a miracle in your life. Only come to Him and ask Him, as Mary Grace said. He opened His arm wide and carry you and care for you. Wonderful. Mary, I'm honored to have you here in the same time to reach these people with the Word of God. And I know you said you study in 3 Bible school, and that it's a blessing. One of them, Rama Bible School, and
Fuller, actually. Fuller Seminary.
And that's wonderful, too. Oh, that's blessing. And you are here from California, or what? You are a California girl, or you come from different states?
Well, I've lived in California for over 13 years.
Oh, okay.
But I grew up in New Jersey.
Oh, okay.
So I'm an East Coast girl, so it's a bit of a mix. I am half East Coast, half LA. But yeah, my family are all on the East Coast, but my spiritual family is here. My friends are here.
How wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are all body of Christ. When you have somebody, you are your family everywhere.
Yes.
And that's, it's a blessing when you have good family as a spiritual or physical family. Now when we talk about many things tonight about mothers, we know that relationship between mother and daughter can build, especially girls. And like I know your mom was so have wonderful influence in you, especially when you see her take her wedding ring and sell it to her to provide for you and your sister and brother wherever you want. And that's a blessing to see it like this. But these days, how you wanna advise mothers and daughters to be together? How they can do work together? There are some mothers that cannot even be friends with their daughter. How you can advise that? As I know you have spiritual kids, that yeah. You can know exactly how to give that word to mothers. They don't know, especially in ages with the girls like 14, 13. Mm-hmm. They will say, oh, I understand everything. I don't need my mother.
Right. Well, I have nieces that age. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're amazing, mm-hmm. beautiful girls, and have so much love and adventure. And I love hanging out with them when I can see them because they're in Florida.
Mm.
But yeah, I mean, it's always a challenge. But I think the most important thing is that that the kids always feel safe to talk to the mom.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, trust. Trust is really big because kids, if they don't trust you,
mm-hmm.
they're not going to tell you anything. And we can't make kids feel like judged or, you know, it's accepting them and listening to them. And sometimes it's not always good things, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, I know some kids who are doing things like, that I really wouldn't recommend. But it's like, you know what? I'm here for you. If in the middle of the night at 2 a.m, I want them to know they can call me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I think as a mother, like when I do have kids, I'm not married right now and I don't have any kids right now. But I have youth in my life and mm-hmm. my nieces and there's other kids in my life. And one thing like I want them to always know is they can call me, they can tell me anything.
Mm.
And I want them to feel like loved and I'm going to give them the right advice.
Wonderful, yes.
Yeah, like I don't want them to ever be afraid to come to me if they need help, mm-hmm. even if they're in trouble.
Mm-hmm. And that the trust, as you said, between a daughter and mother or between aunt and nieces or nephews, mm-hmm. which is true. If they don't have that trust that person and feel secure with, they cannot share their secret.
Yeah.
And that's why sometimes girls, they go to different people to share about their secret more than their mom.
Yeah.
And that sometimes they lead by bad advice from them. And that means we need to be careful as mothers to look about our children and to live the life of mother, good mother that the Lord trusts us to be. I know you still have the future in front of you that to be a wife and to be have a kids, and we pray for wonderful man that from God, not somebody come and said, somebody tell me. But here, one of the thing, you're now doing entertainment business, and we'll go to that. What your plan for your future? What you doing for the future you have now?
Well, I have agents in different states. You have an agent mm-hmm. in Florida, New York, and I'm looking for a new agent right now in LA. I've been mm-hmm. interviewing all this week,
mm-hmm.
and you know, so I'm definitely continuing in acting mm-hmm. and film. I love film and television. I'm going to continue with that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm writing my first book. I hope to finish that this year.
Mm-hmm.
It's a spiritual book, and it's for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
It's for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So that's another aspect of of what I'm doing is my writing. And I'm also, in the long run, I want to produce my own movie. I have some ideas, and I've spoke to a friend who's a New Testament scholar to help me write it. And that's more of a long-term goal, is to produce this feature film. And I want it to be of the nature of like a Star Trek. I want it to be very high budget, very well done, mm-hmm. with great actors. Mm-hmm. I feel like, you know, when David stored up treasure for the temple, mm-hmm. he didn't stop at anything.
Yes.
You know, for his love for God, he wanted the best for God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he, you know, stored up gold, and Solomon built it. Mm-hmm. But it was an immaculate temple, and I feel that way about production. It's mm-hmm. like, if I'm going to do something for the Lord, it's going to be my best. Mm-hmm. And I want it to be top. I want Wonderful. It to be top notch. Mm-hmm. And so that's kind of a 5-year goal of mine. But who knows? Maybe God will provide, and it'll be mm-hmm. a 3-year. Mm-hmm. But that's something down the road that I definitely want to do.
Wonderful. And you are a speaker, and you go all over states to speak. What kind of word you said? What kind of teaching? What you doing with the time you speak?
Well, I've spoken at youth retreats, at a couple women's conferences.
Mm-hmm.
I was asked to speak in Europe at the end of the year, mm-hmm. In hopes that my book would be finished by then. But if it's not, I'll still do it.
Yeah.
So, like, I, you know, wherever it's at, like, I want to. You know, I have a message to speak, mm-hmm. and of light and hope, and I've spoken at churches, mm-hmm. but not only like churches, but like also shows, media, mm-hmm. TV, radio. Spoken on the radio.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. And that people, they call you, how they know about you? Like through some people recommend you, or what? How they know about Mary Grace?
You know, all different ways. I mean, through when the movie came out, I was on Telemundo TV and a lot of radio, and I make friends, you know, with, mm-hmm. and I'm still friends with a lot of the people I did the radio shows with, and they keep in touch with me and ask me what's going on, and they want me on their show again. Mm-hmm. I just spoke to one of the radio hosts just a month ago, and she wants to have me back on. Mm-hmm. And I have friends that I meet every day in film and TV and entertainment production, also in the church. Like I have a friend who's a youth pastor, so he, you know, he invited me to speak at his youth group.
Mm-hmm.
So it's friends, acquaintances, community. I just go with the flow, like with God's spirit, like what comes my way, and
That's wonderful. That's a great when God opens door for you to speak, and you are a wonderful speaker too. I can see in you as you reach, you said youth too, and young and adult in the churches. God use you wherever you are, and to be a light wherever you are in the word you speak. In the same time, here when you said about your story, you write this story to be a movie or what?
Yeah, I'm brainstorming right now about it. My focus is getting my first book done right now. But I am brainstorming about this movie I want to make myself. And I know mm-hmm. God will provide the investors when mm-hmm. it's time.
Mm-hmm.
I want it to be top-notch for mm-hmm. sure when it comes out. And I know a lot of people will jump on because it's mm-hmm. going to be great.
You know, I have somebody asking. They love acting, and they went to school mm-hmm. to be actors. They went to the school, and they have successful the 3 years of study. After that, they come out and they start to have he start to have a little work mm-hmm. in theater and some little business. But there is a time they ask him to do some of the show or the movie. And they ask him to be in this kind of looking. he's handsome, as he said, and all, but when he become like the picture they want him to be, mm-hmm. they said, oh, we don't want you. We have somebody else for that one. And he gets so offended. He doesn't want to do anything. He gets hurt from them. What's your advice to this young actor, and as he hurt from the beginning of his journey?
Yeah, well, it's a tough business. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not a gentle business. It's tough. And you have to let it roll off you. If God's called you, or you feel you're called to entertainment or acting, or any career, really, you know, there's you're going to deal with people who aren't going to treat you right. Mm-hmm. They're going to treat you wrong. They're going to promise you things, and you're not going to get them. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, I could say I paid my dues. Mm-hmm. I mean, over 13 years acting, I went through acting school as well. You know, yes. I went through acting classes and too, and you know, I've done films for free to get the copy when I was just starting out, and I never got the copy. Mm. There's tons of films I've done, I've never got the copy, and I was promised that I worked for free to get the copy. Mm. You know, and or you're on the set, and you know, things go down, and you know, sometimes it's a great experience, sometimes it's not. You know, so I would just say, you know, brush it off. You know, yeah, it hurt. It was disappointing. And just get back up again. Mm-hmm. And just get back up and keep going. Like, be persistent and don't give up. Like, yes. Never give up. Like, mm-hmm. Never give up.
Amen. Yeah. And that's the word, never give up.
Never give up.
Praise God. As we come tonight to the end of our program with a wonderful young lady. She's an actor, she's a producer, speaker, wonderful woman of faith, as we see how God healed her and how God worked in her life in all things. And she is the light in this world through the entertainment business, in the churches, when she speaks. And it was an honor to have you, and you are a wonderful lady. I appreciate you so much, and thank you for coming to be one of us tonight as a guest in the Grace and Hope.
Thank you.
God bless you, and I pray God to bless you and be with you, open more doors, and to be always a light to darkness in this world. Thank you, our wonderful people. We wish mothers a happy Mother's Day. We ask God to bless you, to be with you, enlarge your territory, and give you the desire of your heart. The desire of your heart may be about healing, about financial breakthrough, about the Word of God, to know God and to know exactly who is Jesus is. We ask God to bless you until we'll meet again. Let the Word of God be life in you. And read the Bible, because without the Word of God, we cannot do anything. God bless you and keep you in Jesus' name.